We've been speaking about unity, our series, United, and, you know, just to go over the past couple of weeks, the 2 weeks ago, we talked about our spirit man and our mind, that we have physical, and then we have our spiritual being, and really, what's real is our spirit being, right? And this flesh and blood, this is, seems real right now, but the real thing is heaven. A real thing is the Spirit of God. And as we bring the Spirit into the forefront of who we are, as we build our spirit up and allow that to take precedence, that things change in our lives. Amen. And then last week we talked about being united as people, and there's, you know, there's diversity, but that is the beauty of God's kingdom. There's different peoples, different backgrounds, different, you know, races, and so many differences, but we can't all be hands, we can't all be feet, right? The beauty of the human body is that the different parts of us do different things that allow us to carry out our life in so many different ways. If I had hands down where my feet were and hands where my ears are, I'd just be a mess, right? But there's so many great things about our body and the diversity of the pieces of who we are, and it's the same with the body of Christ. That's what makes it beautiful. That's what allows it to go out and walk on this earth and do so many great things, is that there's so many different things and backgrounds in the body of Christ. We're able to walk out God's word because of diversity and because we've joined in unity in Him. And today I just wanted to talk a little bit about the power. So we've talked about unity and being together, but I want to talk about how the power of God comes through unity, through being in one accord. And you know, we want the power of God to come in our lives. We want things to happen, and you know, it's like, God, move in my life. But we're angry at people, and we don't like this guy or that girl and this, and you know, it's like, well, but you know, God, move in me, you know, let me do something, but I just don't want to like these people. But that's not the way it works, right? That's not the way that God has told us to live. So I want to talk about that, and I want to use the book of Acts primarily today, because the Spirit of God moved. You guys know the book of Acts, right? The early church, that God moved in amazing ways and mightily in that time. But there was something, a big something, that was the catch in that whole story. And it was that they were with one accord. They were unified. They came together as a people and were one as a people. And God used them because they came together in unity. It says it all over the book of Acts, multiple times. And they came together with one accord and prayed. And they came together with one accord. I mean, over and over and over. And after it says that, or before, it's like, it's God moved because they were in one accord. They were in one accord and this happened. Yeah. And you guys, do you understand what I'm saying? Like, can we get that? Can we understand that God does not want there to be division or fighting or strife? He wants us to work together, to love each other, and to walk together hand in hand to do His work. And as we do, as we come together, the Spirit of God will move. Things will happen as we love each other and come together in unity. I want to talk here about Acts 4. And I'm going to go through a couple of different parts of this chapter. But first one is 419. And what was going on here is the church had started to grow. The church had started to move, and there were things that were happening, and there was persecution. The Sanhedrin, the religious people came against them and said, no, we've been doing this thing one way for so long. How in the world do you think you're going to come and just cast out demons in the name of Jesus and pray for people and they're healed? I mean, they are healed in the name of Jesus. We can't deny that. But this is not the way that we've been doing things. You're going to have to stop. So they forbade them from speaking in the name of Jesus. And they came to him and they're like, look, we're going to have to call you on this. In verse 19, it says, but Peter and John answered and said to them, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you more than to God, you can judge. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. Wow. I just want to get out of this scripture right here that there's a couple of things in the next couple of scriptures. But first of all, they had faith. They believed. They said, you can tell us whatever you want. You can say to me, don't do things in the name of Jesus. You can tell me that I'm wrong, but all I can do is go in what I have seen and I've heard. I have experienced the presence of God. I have seen Jesus. He's with me, and I'm going to continue to do this. Do what you will, but I'm following Jesus. I have faith. I'm going to move forward. So first and foremost, we have to believe and have faith in who God is and what Jesus did on the cross for us. There was persecution. See, I mean, you know, there's lots of stuff these days. Lots of stuff going on in our lives or, you know, fighting and strife and persecution. I mean, there's bad persecution around the world, but here, I mean, we don't really even have to deal with it that bad. I mean, somebody might say, I don't believe what you believe and, you know, you're crazy or whatever. I mean, that's the worst we get. But we run scared sometimes. We're like, I don't know what I'm going to do. Where's your faith? Where's your belief and your knowing who God is and what he's done? That Jesus has come and he's saved you. That he's changed you. He's God. And he's with us and ready to move. So we have faith. So in verse 24, they came together. Peter and John, they came and said, this is what just happened. But they couldn't hold us. They knew what we were doing was right. They just didn't want us to do it. And so they came together and they prayed for boldness. I love this. It says, so when they had heard that, the people had heard that, they raised their voice to God with one accord. When they had heard that, there's persecution, but we have faith. And they came together. So we have faith, and then we need to have unity. So we're building on this, right? I'm going to tell you what we need to move forward in the power of God. This is what happened in the early church, and this is what the Bible says. I mean, you want to know how things work and the way we should live, and it's right here in the Word of God. So they had faith, and they came together in unity and prayed together. And then in 29 it says, as they prayed, now, Lord, look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word. Faith, unity, and with unity comes boldness, or they're asking for boldness and praying for that together as a people. And God had granted it to them. In verse 31, it says, and when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Okay, You guys seeing this? We're like building. There's stuff going on, but we have faith. We know who God is. It doesn't matter what you say. We are going to believe God. We are going to trust Jesus. We believe him, and I have faith in him. And then they come together, and with unity and one accord, they come together and pray together. You guys know that any sports team or Army or what other kind of teams or whatever. I don't, anything like that. You come, they come together as one in order to accomplish their goal. Can you imagine whether it's a sports team or whether it's an army? This one guy going out, I'm going to get it all done. I'm the greatest. I can do all, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, but he's asked us to come together so that we can accomplish his greater work in this earth, right? So you see this guy going out. You ever seen those movies? You see the big army all across the whole hill, and they're just lined up. Imagine it was just one guy. And he's like, I'm ready to go. And there's this big army in front of him. And he's like, and he just starts running, one guy. You know, what do you think the army's going to do? On the other side, they're going to be like, oh, this is interesting. I mean, he might get one of us or two of us, but, I mean, we have thousands of people. But that's not the way that it works, is it? No, you have on the other side the army that's thousands upon thousands of people, lines after line after line, going so deep. And whenever they are ready to go, and their captain tells them, and they're like, ah! And it's not just a, you know, it's this roar that's so loud that shakes the ground, right? And they move in their feet because they're walking in unison. It shakes the ground, and they're yelling. And then the guys on the other side are like, oh, okay, this is a little more intimidating. We've got a battle on our hands. I'm not sure if we can actually beat this army that's coming at us. See, as opposed to one man. It's the same in the body of Christ. We're God's children, brothers and sisters, and if we're fighting and arguing and bickering and can't get along with each other, then what are we going to accomplish? One guy, I've got it all. You're wrong. I'm right. I'm going to go do everything. I mean, you know, you can get a little accomplished. But together, as God's people, as his army, see, we have to run together in one accord, holding arms together, shoulder to shoulder. And as we run and we scream, we go, ah, look out, we're coming. And our feet are running and the ground's shaking. And all of a sudden, the enemy is just shaking in his boots, right? He's just, I thought I was just going to have to deal with one man. But I've got an army of God's children after me. Come on now. And that's what happened here in the book of Acts. They came together with one accord. They had faith. They were in unity. They were together. And they prayed and asked God, God, give us all that we need to move forward in what you've called us to. And as they did, the place where they were was shaken. How many of you want to see that? I want to see that. As we come together, if this place is going to be shaken, if this city or this world is going to be shaken by the power of God, it's going to be because we're all together, because we're moving in sync, because we're holding arms and running side by side. Not because one man is running out there doing something, but because together we are running. This world is going to be shaken. It will. It will be shaken. It will. And then they were given boldness. Boldness comes. Look, people can be bold by themselves. But when you got your people with you, when you got your people standing next to you, right? You're like, what? What are you going to do? I'm all right, but look at this guy here and this guy here. Look at this whole group of people with me. What are you going to do? I mean, the boldness comes as we gather together in unity. And it's not us. It's not. It's God in us. And it's him that brings the boldness. See, they ask for it, and it says that God gave them boldness. But if we're not together, if we're not in unity, if we're not working together, it's going to be okay. But I don't want it to be okay. I want it to be great. I want God to move so big that people are like, oh my God. And you're like, yeah, exactly. That's right. God. They're like, they can't help but notice what God is doing because we're coming together in His name, in unity with Him. Amen? We have to unite ourselves around the Word of God. Like I said, I mean, how do you come together? Well, the Bible plainly tells us how we are to live our lives. We have to come together in the Word of God and what He's spoken. See, this Bible is one big story, as I've said before, about Jesus, what led up to Him, why He had to come, when He did come, and then after He came. What we unify around is Him. And you know what He was? He was love. He was grace and peace. All these things that we're told in here, it's not like, hey, this isn't who God is, but you need to be this way. This is who God is. That's why it tells us to be that way, right? Love people. Run with them arm in arm. Help them. Share with them the love of God and exude the grace of God, because that's who God is and that's who He's asked us to be. In John 14, 12, it says, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will also do. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. I love this. Greater works are supposed to happen. Not just to the people in Acts in the first church, that great things were happening, not just 100 or 200 years, but ongoing generation after generation doing greater and greater works than Jesus did on the earth. But why is it that we don't see that all the time? We see glimpses of it. We see things happening, like in the book of Acts, or if you know about like Azusa Street, or these different moves of God that have happened. And why is that? Well, I don't know. Why don't you look and see that in Acts, all their mind was on God and being together as one people, trying to so as much as possible think and dwell on the same thing, which is God and love and peace and reaching out. And in Azusa Street, what was the deal? Well, they came together and they're like, we are going to sit in this room and pray and be here until God does something big. We're just going to sit. We're together. All of us, it doesn't matter where we're from or who we are. We just come together in this room and God is going to move. If He doesn't move today or tomorrow or the next day, fine. We're sitting here until He does. We're coming together in unity. And then God shows up in huge ways. It's not a one-man race. It's a team. It's God's children coming together in one accord. Like in the book of Acts, as we come together and we have faith and we seek after Him and we pray for boldness and we're there in one accord that He says, all right, here I am. And the place is shaken. And the boldness comes. And we move forward and do great things. Oh. See, too many people have forgotten. In Galatians 5:22, what it says. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another or envying one another. I mean, this whole scripture right here is basically telling us these are the fruit. This is what happens when the Spirit of God is in you. When the Spirit of God is moving in your life, there's love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, all these things. Not strife, not fighting, not envy. And I know we deal with that sometimes. It's just, it's a battle, right? But if we are looking at the Word of God and saying, how should I live? It's to love one another. It's to walk with them arm in arm, side by side, together. Again, no matter where we're from, what background, what race, what's happened in your past, it doesn't matter. What matters is what we're focused on, and that's Jesus Christ. Who we are worshiping and who we are coming to be with, that is what matters. Not anything in us or in our past. And if we can come together in unity in that way, we'll be amazed. And I know we do. I'm not saying we don't in this church. I'm always amazed at the love of the people in this church and many people around the world. But as I spoke, I think it was last week, I said there's 38,000 different denominations. Can you believe that? 38,000 different denominations because, you know, one church was doing well, but one guy said, well, I kind of believe this a little differently. I'm going to start my own denomination. And then another guy is like, well, I believe a little differently, so I'm going to start my own denomination. We're all going to just run almost side by side, but go in a little bit different direction. And all of a sudden, the church starts splitting off and going different ways and not being one and unified. And then the church loses its strength of being together and being unified. Man, could you imagine if the church comes together and says, we're going to do what God has told us to do, and we are going to come as one people all over the world. It wouldn't take years or maybe even months. Because I said it last week. I don't know how many Christians are. And Jack, who's a missionary, of course, he would know. There's like 2.7 billion Christians in the world. Not just a few, not just a few hundred. 2.7 billion Christians. What if we all came together with unity and in one accord and one mind to do what God has asked us to do? Imagine what he could do through us. Wow. But again, it's not us. It's not me. It's not you. It's not because I'm great or you're great, even though we all are, right? God made us amazingly. We all have different gifts and strengths in us, every single one of us, to do things for God and with him and him through us. But it's not us, it's him. It's him that moves through us. And imagine again, that group of people. I said first service, I'm going to say it again. Do you remember when you were a kid and you were in grade school and you played Red Rover? I'm sorry. You guys don't play this anymore. I guess it's outdated. Yeah, well, I mean, too many kids got hurt, you know. I mean, we're afraid of kids getting hurt nowadays. I just send my kids out and say, get hurt. Learn something. Learn something. Get tough. Don't be a wimp. Just kidding. Kind of. But we played Red Rover. You guys remember that game? And you're locked arm in arm with the guy next to you. And you say, Red Rover, send Tori right over. And Pastor Tori, she's over there in that other line, that intimidating group. But when she breaks away from the group, she's just one person, right? She breaks away from that group, and it's just her coming across, and I'm locked arm in arm with the guy on this side of me and the guy this side of me, and she's running, and tries to break through. You know, you try to pick the weak spot in the you know, line of people, right? But she tries to break through, and she can't because we're locked arm in arm, because we're holding each other up, right? You know, whenever the enemy attacks us, he tries to pick us off the easy pickings. Or when we're separated from each other. You're like, oh, you know, you guys ever watch any of those nature shows, right? Whew, those get a little rough sometimes. You're like, oh, the little deer running across it. And then all of a sudden this lion comes out, you know. But he doesn't go for the pack. He doesn't go for the biggest deer, the biggest meal. He goes for the little one that's straggling behind, that's separated from the pack. It's the same. The enemy wants us to be separated, wants us to be divided. He's not stupid. He knows that together we're stronger. He knows that God moves in greater ways when we're locked arm in arm, together in unity. That's why, you know, we have community groups, and you guys, you know, anybody ever felt like, I'm gonna be a part of the community group. It's gonna be awesome. I'm gonna grow and meet new people, and it's gonna be awesome. And all of a sudden, something comes in your mind. It's like, I don't know if they'll like you. I'm not sure if you're kind of their kind of people. You know, they might not like where you've been or what you've done or who you are. You know why he does that? Because he wants to keep us separated from our people. He wants to keep us in division and away from each other, because just like that lion that comes and attacks the weakest and the separated one, he's going to do the same. So he's going to try everything he can to get you to unlock arms with the person next to you. But when we come locked arm in arm together like this, you know, we're just holding on to each other, and sickness or something coming against us, some attack against our family or what have you, something in our job is messing with us. You know, if I'm standing, hey, I'm not standing by anybody. I'm just by myself. I could be knocked down pretty easy. But if we are together, joined arm in arm, linked together, you know, something can come. Let it come. You might be able to knock me down, but look at these guys standing next to me. I've got, you know, big guy over here and big guy over here. These are my people, my family. They're holding me up. I may be getting knocked, and, you know, you can get knocked around, but when you're locked arm in arm, when we're in unity and one accord, it's not going to knock us down, because we got the other guy holding us up. They're with us. They're here for us. That's what God wants from his people. Not only that we can stand strong in an attack, but that we move forward together, shoulder to shoulder, an intimidating army for the will of God. Amen? Wow. Philippians 2:1, it says, therefore, if there's any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy. I love he's saying it's like, I mean, if there's any of this in you, you're gonna need to walk in unity, right? It's like, if there's any love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, affection and mercy, then you have to walk in unity. Verse 2, it says, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, letting each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of the others. Don't just look out for yourself. Don't just take care of me. Everybody else can do whatever they want, but I'm just going to take care of me. That's the tendency that we have. But God says, no. You guys are you're my children. You're the ones that I love, and I want you to love each other just like I've loved you. I want you to stand for one another just like I've stood for you. I want you to be there, hold each other up, build each other up, strengthen each other, that at any time there's some attack, that it won't just be you alone, but it'll be those around you, holding you, helping you to get through. Oh. I mean, it's not new to us today, but there's always been this thing of dissension and tearing apart and wanting to do it our own way. But just like back in Acts, the word of the hour, is unity. It's one accord. Yeah. It's staying in one accord together, coming together as family, as brothers and sisters, and holding each other up, because that is where God is going to move. Yes. He can move when you're out on your own, and he will, but imagine us all with the gifts that he's given us, the power that he's placing in each side of us and using us for, that if we come together, you know, you guys remember the story of the Battle of Jericho, that God told him to march around the city, this huge wall. It was a fortified city, and you know, what are they going to do? But he said, just march around that city and pray and worship God. And then at the end, I'm going to let you know when, but then you're going to yell and just scream and praise God to the best of your ability. You're just going to worship him and scream out. And what happened? Those people were walking around that city, that wall standing strong. But when it came time for God to move, he said, all right, it's time. Just worship me and just praise me and scream my name. And you imagine all those people. It wasn't, again, one guy. Praise God. It was a people together, united for what God wanted to do, that all together they yelled. And I imagine, you know, and then again, it wasn't their ability or because they screamed so loud or because they were so strong, but because they came together and worshiped God and screamed out his name. And I just imagine God placing his hands like this, you know, right around their heads, you know, like a megaphone. And as they screamed and worshiped him, he just amplified their voices. He amplified the power that he had given them, but he just multiplied it time after time so that it just tore down those walls because they came together. Because they came together in unity for him and to do his will. And that's what we're called to do. Not to yell on our own, but to come together and sing praises and glorify God. And as we do that together, imagine God just putting his hands around our mouths and amplifying our voices. So where it's not just my voice, it's not just your voice, it's not all of our voices, but then it's God, his voice going through us, just in a crazy roar to move and to do his will. Amen? Why don't you stand with me?